Hello, and welcome to the ongoing online Music Hum materials for the Section 24 Music Hum My Class. I'm Brad Garten. This is going to be for Thursday, April 9th. That's the third video. And we're going to talk about the third composer we're going to talk about at the beginning of this kind of modernist movement was Béla Bartók. Okay, born in Hungary in 1881. And died 1945. You might think that it was a World War II occurrence, but no, he'd managed to successfully immigrate to the United States prior to that. So it wasn't as a result of any of the war problems. We're going to talk about his death in a little bit. But, you know, if you can imagine Stravinsky representing kind of the neo-primitive, you know, kind of intuitive sort of atonal composer. By the way, Stravinsky eschewed that as he got older, and he became what he called a craftsman, and he didn't like the excesses of his youth. I like them, but Stravinsky didn't. But if you think of Stravinsky as that kind of strain of modernism developing, and Schoenberg representing the more kind of hyperstructure, hyper-academic, you know, needs some kind of a basis sort of thing, Bartók was in the Stravinsky camp. You know, he was definitely... He did some amazing things, but a lot of his work was fueled by the fact that his first job in Hungary was as an ethnomusicologist. He was employed by the government to go out and actually document Hungarian folk music. This was actually a job they had. So he traveled around and discovered just an amazingly rich world of music, just like many of the nationalist composers at the end of the Romantic era. And his first works were kind of very much in that tradition. I want to play you a couple of pieces from a composition he did called A Dance Suite, which is just a set of, I think, six different dances based on Hungarian folk melodies. So here's the first one. Okay, so you can hear it's got a lot of dynamism, a lot of drive, very interesting harmonies, but that was actually the harmonies that this folk music had. So Bartók was being kind of steeped in this, you know. Here's another one from the dance suite. I like this one quite a bit. So you can hear this is really kind of, you know, straight kind of neo-tonal, very sort of overt folk type music that Bartók was writing. But he had an intense musical creative genius. And what he did was begin to abstract some of these harmonic principles that he had documented and began to apply them to a whole new way of composing. Now, about this time, he also emigrated to the United States. This is beginning to be the late 1930s. He'd always been very sickly and was having a tough time of it. And he saw the growing Nazi threat and thought, this is not the place I want to be. So he was able to wind up in New York City. Talk about that again in a bit more. But I just want to play you what he started doing. He started writing very densely atonal works. But the atonality is rooted in what he had learned as this documenter of ethnic musics. He wrote a series of six string quartets that are just gems of modernist composition, and we still study them intensely today. This is the Allegro, the first movement of his fourth string quartet, and I'll just play a little bit of it to give you a sense of what it sounds like. So you can hear it's pretty densely atonal music. He was not widely known as a composer in his lifetime. People that were kind of in the know heard this music and said, this is intense stuff. And they really kind of like worked on understanding what he was trying to do. And in fact, some of those people were right here at Columbia University. And when Bartok wound up in New York, nearly penniless, Columbia gave him a job. Which was really good because, unfortunately, like I said, he was kind of sickly. It turns out he had leukemia, and he died here in 1945 at a fairly young age. But even up to his dying day, he was still writing and composing this intense music, and he was also engaging kind of older forms sometimes. I'm going to play you, this is what a piece he wrote towards the end of his life called Music for Strings, Percussion, and Celesta. Celesta is that keyboard instrument that plays bells, Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairies, and Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker Suite. But I want to play the beginning of this and see if you can guess what the form of this music is. Have any of you guessed what's going on here? It's a fugue. It's a strict four-voice fugue. But it's not like anything Bach ever wrote. I mean, that melody, da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da, you'll hear it come in again, and then you'll hear it come in again, then you'll hear it come in again at the fourth. You know, this is part of how he constructed his fugue, and basically follows the rules of counterpoint. The difference being that these rules are now not moored to the tonal system at all. It's free-floating tonality using whatever harmonies Bartok is able to conceive of in his mind. It makes for really intense music. Anyhow, I want to end by just playing a piece a bit earlier than that. This is his piano concerto number 2. It's for piano and orchestra. And I want to play it because I want to tell you a story about it in class on Thursday. But this is how it starts out. Again, very much informed by this Hungarian sort of ethnic dance music. Very overt, okay? So very intense, very rhythmic, very allegro first movement for this. But it's the second movement that really gets me. And that's the one I want to tell a story about. I'm going to play a little bit of it because this is just an incredible piece of music. Just beautiful. Okay, that's it for now.